All right, so we were looking at UDP sockets, right? We saw that we can create UDP sockets between server and client. Then we can transfer information. And we also saw that by using UDP sockets, there are certain limitations, right? And for example, if the server is not running, the client wouldn't know, right? Or the server has stopped running, server shut down, the client still wouldn't know, right? So there's no error checking, there's no flow control, there's no checking of whether the server is running or not. That's the limitation of the UDP. And we saw that one way to do that, one way to overcome one limitation of UDP is to use the connect function in the UDP socket. So what the connect function do in the UDP socket is basically to see whether the server is running. That's all. It does not do any handshaking. It just checks whether the server is running, and then it can actually show you the error condition if it's not running. Okay. Now, next thing we're going to look at is in terms of flow control. Right? Now, we said that earlier that UDP does not employ flow control capability. Means that UDP does not handle flow control. Means that if the communication between the server and client gets too much, the other side would not be able to handle. Right? So the idea is that between server and client, if we send data too fast between the server and client, one of the side will be overwhelmed. So we have a client, then we have the server. Right? So let's say client sends something, and then the server sends back something back. Now if data, this is very large, data coming in from the server, and if the buffer is not enough, the buffer is not sufficient, to store all the incoming data on the socket, then there'll be overflow. Right? If a lot of data is being sent by the server to the client, and the client's buffer is not so large, it cannot keep all the data into the buffer, then some of it will be lost because it's overflow. Right? Why happens? Because the server and client does not check how much data can you send before you transmit. In TCP, we do that. During the handshaking, the client and the server will tell each other, this is my buffer size. Right? You remember the socket options. It tells you what the buffer size and how much data I can send you. Right? So then we will make sure that the data sent can be accommodated in the receive buffers. But in UDP, no such thing. Because there's no handshaking, each side does not know how much capability you have of storing the incoming data. So we just send and we hope for the best. Right? So what we're going to do here in this particular example is that we're going to send, the client is going to send 2,000 packets to the server. And each packet is about 1,400 bytes. Right? And we send the packets very, very fast for the client. So the client is running on a fast machine, it will send quickly. Right? On the server side, what we're going to do is that it's basically going to count the number of packets received from the client. And then it will display how many packets you actually received, which were sent by the client. Right? So the client side, very simple the program. So our DG client now, we just modify a little bit. We're going to make it very simple. We're just going to say we have a loop here, and then we're going to send data to the server. Right? So what we're going to send data is basically, we're going to send it multiple times. So how many multiple times you're going to send is you're going to send 2,000 times the loop, and each time we send the length of 1,400 bytes. Right. So we create a buffer the size of 1,400 bytes here, and then for each loop we're going to send this particular buffer. Currently the buffer is empty. It doesn't matter because in UDP, as you saw, previously that we can send empty buffers. Right, it's okay. Right. So on the server side, we modify the echo, DG echo program. What we're going to do is that we have a for loop, and then what we're going to do is we're going to receive the data coming in from the client. Right. So each time we receive, we'll put into it into a buffer, and then we count how many times we have received, we have read the data from the client. Right. And then we also enable our signal. Right. So once we stop our server program, it will run this particular signal function. I will call signal function and run this particular interrupt program, right? Function here. So what this does is basically to print out how many packets were received, how many UDP datagrams were received when we interrupt our server program, right? So the example given in the textbooks like this. So before we run the program, we're going to display the statistics of the current statistics on the system. Right, so we're going to run this particular statement, netstat minus s minus p UDP. That means we're only going to display the data which is related to UDP. Right. So we're going to display this particular data, then we're going to run our server. Run our server, and on other machine, we run the client. Right, so the client will actually send the data to the server. So once the client finish, then we interrupt our server. And once we interrupt our server, it will display how many packets were received. Right? Then we display the same statement again, and we check from the difference between the figures in the previous and in the before and the after. Right? So now our client, if you notice, there are a couple of things to look here. One is the datagrams received, the main one. The rest we can ignore. Datagrams received, how many packets were dropped due to socket full buffers, and how many were delivered. Right. So in other words, so the client will send 2,000 packets to the server. Right. So server will see how many will go into the buffer, how many were received, and how many were dropped. That means they were not, could not be put into the buffer itself because the buffer size is limited, right? So you notice here the before and after. So datagrams received, and datagrams received now is increase of 2,000, right? Because our client program has sent 2,000 packets earlier. So this figure should tally, right? So 2,000 difference. And delivered, that means how many were actually received. And you notice that the difference between this figure and this figure is about 30. And our server program will also report that 30 UDP packets were received. Out of 2,000 sent, 30 were received, which is displayed by the server program, and is actually checked, also can be counter-checked by the netstat statistics. So 30 has been delivered. So the missing one is basically the dropped. So earlier our packets dropped due to full buffer, so 1971. And after running our program, you will see that the figure has changed, and now it has increased by 1970. So you add these two up, you get 2,000. All right. So basically, we need to understand this particular statistics to figure out how many packets were actually received, how many were not received because the buffers were full. Right. Okay. Let's run the program. Right. So the book was saying that if we change the other way around. Right, so in this case, they are giving another example. In this case, we are still sending the same number of packets, but now our client is sending the packets very slowly. If the client is sending the packets slowly and the server is processing the packets fast on a faster machine, then it would be okay. because the server is picking out the packet, reading the packets. Packets are coming in slowly, so it's able to read fast. So this should be okay. So in this case, 2000 would have been read, right? Compared to the earlier one, which is only about 30. Yeah. Now again, we can't recreate this problem on our machine. Another way to solve this is that we change the socket receive buffer size. So earlier, if we have a problem that we know that a lot of packets coming in, on the UDP packet coming in, and they are dropped because the buffer size is not enough, right? So what we can do is we can increase the buffer size. And we have seen the socket option last time to increase the buffer size. So what this particular example given is that, so in the echo function, the server side, we try to increase the socket receive buffer. So how do we do that? It's somewhere here, right? So we set socket option. Set socket option, we open the socket, and then we say which is the family type, the socket family, SQL, SOL socket, and then the receive buffer. This is what we're going to manipulate now. We're going to set this particular buffer size with a new value. What new value is calculated here, right? So now it's basically about 220 times 1024. Right? So the size has been increased now, right? And since we set the receive buffer, increase the buffer size, then we run the same program again and see and count and see whether there is a, whether it can accept more packets now. Right? So logically it should work. So the example given in the book is that the default UDP size is about 42,000 bytes. Right? So that should be just enough to store about 30 packets. So in our earlier example, we only saw about 30 packets were received. Right here. 30 datagrams were received because buffer size is such, it only can accept about that much. So once we increase the socket receive buffer size, and then we run the client and the server, so in this case, the server will be able to increase, to receive more packets, to accept more packets coming in from the client. So if you run again, then you should be get from 30 to about more of them. Right? Again, we can't recreate this problem because our problem is solved. In this particular machine, it can accept a large number of UDP packets coming in. So there is a, we can try afterwards, right, to how to set a socket size. Right. Now next we take a brief look at how we can use to view our outgoing interface, right, using UDP sockets. So this particular example gives us that what we're going to do is that we're going to find out what IP number was our UDP packets sent out. So on the client side, we're sending the packets. So what is the IP number of our client on we send out, right? So this is what basically the program does. So same thing again, it creates a UDP socket, fill information. Now it connects the socket to the server, and then uses a function called getSocketName. We have seen that earlier. GetSocketName is the one which is a function to get the local address of your socket. That means the local IP number and the port number. Right? So here we're only displaying the local address. So if you run this program, you'll get something like this. Right? It will tell you what is the local address of your machine. Right, so the last part, we look at how we can combine the TCP and UDP sockets together. Right, so we have seen that we can create UDP sockets on the client and server. But the thing is that if you run a UDP client, you must connect to a UDP socket. You must connect to a UDP server. If you run a TCP client, you must connect to a TCP server. Right, you cannot mix the both. Mix the both, it will not work. So one way to overcome this is that what we can do, we can create a server which can handle both TCP clients as well as UDP clients. So that means now this particular server must create two sockets. Create a TCP socket to handle TCP clients, and also to create a UDP socket to handle UDP clients. So now we have two sockets created on the server, and we're going to monitor both of them using select. Right? That's what it's going to do. So in this case, our server will now create two sockets. So server will create one socket, which is TCP, and then you create another one called a UDP socket. Right, so TCP clients will connect to this, UDP clients will connect to this, right, separately. And we're going to run the select. Between them, we check which one has some activity. The moment one of them has activity, we will run the particular part of it, right? So this particular program, what it does is basically combine the two. It's very simple. You take the TCP client on the server side and UDP server code, and basically combine the two, right? So first we create a TCP socket, right? The same ones. Create a socket, sock stream now, and then we give the name, and then we bind it with the, we initialize the socket structure, put in the family type, put a default IP address and the port number, right? Then we bind the socket we created earlier. So this, and then we start a listening process. The same. This part is for the TCP part. And then we create another one, another socket. This time it is a UDP socket. And again, so this is a different socket structure, right? Or we can use the same socket structure. Fill in the information again. And now we bind this particular UDP socket to the socket structure we have created. Right, so we have two sockets now. Now here it uses a socket set socket option, line 20. So what it does to do is it shows that it, what it does is to say it wants to reuse the address. Right, so we're going to use the reuse address option to say it is now on. Right, so on is one. Okay, so we want to set this. That means basically we want to use the same server again for multiple processes running on the same IP number. Reuse the address. Right, so we have created a TCP socket as usual. Bind it and then start listening process. We create a UDP socket, we bind it. And then now we're going to, here we set, then we use this for the select function. So then we set for the descriptor, the socket descriptor, we say that listen socket, the TCP socket and the UDP socket is the one which we want to monitor. So we set this socket in the R set, our reading set for the select. So we're going to monitor these two. Then we run the select function on the R set. So R set knows that it's listening for these two sockets now. After that, we check. Is the TCP socket currently has activity? If it is, then we handle the TCP way. Right? So if it's a TCP socket, then what we normally do, we accept. Right? We accept the particular incoming client connection. And then in this case, then we do the fork process, the fork function to create a child process, and then we do a string echo, right, as usual. If it is a UDP socket which has been set, that means there is connection from a UDP client, right? So then what we do, we just basically, we use a different function, receive from and then send to, right? So we're going to receive the data from the UDP client, and then we reply back to the UDP client using the send to. Right? So the idea is that we handle the TCP traffic and the UDP traffic separately. Right? We use if else function to monitor this. So how do we know which one is which? We basically use the select then. Right? So select gives us flexibility of monitoring both traffic at the same time, UDP as well as TCP. After that, we check one by one. If TCP socket has some activity, then what do we do? If UDP, then what do we do? Right? Okay, so let's try to run this. If you look at this code, if the connection coming in from the TCP client, right? What do? We accept the TCP client's connection, and then we do a fork, right? So for the TCP connection, we use a fork. That means the server will make a copy of itself. And then the child process of the server will communicate with the TCP client. But for UDP, there's no fork. Right? It just reply between the sender and receiver. You understand? Right, so for TCP, there is a fork function. Right, so now, right, so the code is not very difficult. It's basically pretty simple. We just combine the two parts of the TCP and UDP together. So the server can handle both TCP and UDP clients now, right, as and when required. Okay, so you should try the remaining parts of the exercise. Right, sending packets to the server and counting the packets. You can check this, the socket buffer size, displaying outgoing, especially the last one. Right, handling both TCP and UDP using Slack. So here you run the client, run the server, and then try to run two different clients. One is the UDP client, the other is a TCP client at the bottom. Right, so run the two clients simultaneously and see what happens, and see whether you can monitor both of them. Right. Okay, so that'll be the end for today. All right?